Ephesians 4, 17 to 19. So I tell you this, and insist on it in the Lord, that you must no longer live as Gentiles do, in the futility of their thinking. They are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. Having lost all sensitivity, they have given themselves over to sensuality so as to indulge in every kind of impurity, and they are full of greed. This is the word of the Lord.
We live in a world where the grass often seems greener on the other side, and Paul in these verses in particular takes an in-depth look at the life of those who do not know God, and he wants to remove any curiosity about them or jealousy that we might have. Paul is seeking to encourage both a mature people and a mature church. His main thought is that the members of the Ephesian congregation must no longer live as the surrounding culture does. I want you to examine your own hearts. Look at how you lived over the last 5 years. Were you different from those around you? Have you been accumulating like your neighbours? Have you been gripped with fear like your neighbours? Have you grieved like your neighbours? Have you cocooned like your neighbours, shutting yourself off from others? Have you lusted after things like your neighbours? And the fact that he says no longer suggests that either they've having come to faith out of paganism, either there were many in the Ephesian church who were slow to grow, slow to move on in righteousness, still babes in Christ, infants as he calls them in verse 14, or they were still largely indistinguishable from the godless people around them. They were still a long way off what they were meant to be and what they were meant to become. We've had the joy of watching our children grow up and also watching other people's children grow up. There are some children we know who are now fine-looking, even stunning, but who as babies were among the most ugliest infants I've ever seen. My wife won't let me tell you which of my relatives I'm talking about, but she knows. But yet they grew into lovely people, but at the beginning, unbelievable. We were fortunate our children were marvellous right from this. Paul is looking at his congregation and he sees them still as infants, having hardly grown. So many in the Ephesian church were a long way from resembling what they were meant to be. And Paul starts this chapter by urging them to live a life worthy of the calling they have received. It seems a lot of them had a foot in each camp. And isn't that a problem for all of us? We are not yet what we will be. We are not yet made perfect. We are not yet in heaven. Sure, but for many of us, we have not yet made a complete break. The scriptures teach us that we have three enemies we have to contend against: the flesh, that is ourselves, the world, and the devil. And the flesh, and this could be a sermon in itself, here we are as new creations. We declare Christ as King, if you're a follower of Jesus, and yet in our very being we have something like terrorists running around wanting to blow things up. In Romans 6:11, Paul says, in the same way, count yourselves dead to sin but alive to God in Christ Jesus. And he says, do not let sin reign in your mortal body. It's there, but don't let it reign so that you obey its evil desires. As John Owen is often quoted for saying, you must be killing sin or sin will be killing you. But not only the flesh, we have the world. We live in a world that is aligned against God. We live in a system that is increasingly organized against God and his people. So that while we must live in the world, we have to struggle to not be of the world. The waves of thought and thinking around us, we can easily get caught up in it. As I mentioned last week, the older people get caught up in it by just watching TV and the news 1 hour a day, and the younger people are getting caught up in it from their cell phones, and some are getting hit both with both of those things. Maybe the Generation X in the middle are getting hit on all sides. We need to struggle against that, but we also have the devil who takes an increasing interest in us when we put up a flag of loyalty to God and declare that Jesus is Lord. Now, some of you here today, the devil had very little interest in you a few years ago, but now he's very interested and he sees you as a threat. He wants to push back. He wants to knock over. He wants to get us distracted. He wants to get us off track. And we have to struggle not to shrink back, but to resist and press on and hold our ground. Now, we know in heaven we'll have new bodies and we'll be perfected, and sin will no longer run around in our bodies trying to take over. There will be a new heavens and a new earth, and there will be no knee that doesn't acknowledge any other king but Jesus. And the devil and all his minions and all who have given him allegiance will be shut up and shut away forever. But we're not there yet. And Paul knows the struggle and the allure, and so he says, don't be deceived, don't compromise, and don't be like those who don't know Jesus, who give themselves to the flesh, who walk the broad way of this world with all its fads, and who know no struggle against the devil because they are no threat to him. Something Paul does in his writings, and it's something I learned a few years ago, along with the other writers of Scripture, instead of saying, try not to think about what tempts you. You know, if you see something on TV and you try not to think about it, it's sometimes all you can think about. But what Paul does, instead of saying, try not to think about it, sometimes he'll take the exact reverse approach and he'll hold it up for you to see it for what it really is. He holds up the bait for you to see, and he takes a microscope to it and reveals the rusty hook that wants to reel you in. I love a good meat pie. And when you go to the supermarket, you can get 4 meat pies for the price of what you might pay ordinarily at the bakery. And they look so shiny and so tasty on the packet. Now, in my condition, it is not good to eat meat pies, and particularly not supermarket meat pies. Now, I could try not to think about them, but I find something far more effective than that to wean me off them, and it's this. Look at them closely. Not under a microscope, but just read the ingredient list on the back. You can't imagine all the garbage and unrecognizable chemicals that make up your supermarket store bought meat pie. It's a list this long with about 100 ingredients. All I want is pastry and meat. And it's a long list. And at the very beginning of the list is beef fuel. At least it's there. Not 60 or 80%, but 10 or 15% if you're lucky. No, don't look away, but look closely. Consider the consequences. It's what Solomon does in the Proverbs so effectively. Proverbs 5, he says, for the lips of the adulterous woman drip honey, and her speech is smoother than oil. But in the end, she is bitter as gall, sharp as a double-edged sword. Her feet go down to death, and her steps lead straight to the grave. And that is what Paul is doing so effectively here. You must no longer live as the pagan nations do, yet their influence is pervasive. And sometimes it seems like they have all the fun and that everything's working for them. But don't look away. Look closer, he says. Look at verse 17. Their thinking is futile. In the end, it gets them nowhere. Their understanding is shadowy. They now think that men can have babies. They think all sorts of crazy ideas. They are separated from the life of God, he says in verse 18. They're separated from real spiritual life. They are ignorant. They have no knowledge of what really matters. They don't know how they got here. They don't know what they're supposed to be doing here. And they don't know where they're going. And their hearts are hardened. They're a shell of what they could be. He says, don't be like that. Don't get mixed up in that. And then in verse 19, it gets worse. They have lost all sensitivity. And again, I'm saying this not to say, oh, look at them, look how bad they are. Paul is saying, you're like this, many of you. You've got caught up in this. Don't be like this. You need to stand out. Having lost all sensitivity, he says in verse 19. This is a word that means to cease to feel pain or grief, to become callous. Some translations describe the word as being past feeling. And you sometimes meet people, you may even have some in your own family, who are so hardened, they seem impervious to others' hurts or to others' feelings. And it doesn't mean they don't feel, but they are only sensitive to their own feelings. Everything is interpreted on how it makes them feel. Others' feelings or concerns are irrelevant. They only look down here. They never look out there or up there. They are only their only consideration is themselves and their small universe. And here particularly, this has to do with sensitivity to God. They lack moral feeling and discernment as it relates to God. I once had an elder say to me after I gently corrected him, not from this church, "Don't you quote that book at me," talking about the Bible. It's not quite that that Paul's talking about here, because even though he didn't like it, at least it made an impact. The lack of sensitivity Paul is talking about is they have no effective antenna for God at all, or the things for God. They don't make them angry. They don't stir them up. They're just impervious to it. And I always worry more about those who are unmoved than those who are reactive and angry to the things of God. Those who are angry are acknowledging there's something real there. It's to become numb and like a leper. You know, lepers will lose all their feelings and their extremities. To lose any normal or natural restraint against the things that are dangerous and cause lasting spiritual damage. Some today are so hardened that even severe judgment does not move them. You see people knocked around and yet they still don't look to God. Isaiah 42 verse 25 says, "God poured out on them in his burning anger the violence of war. It enveloped them in flames, yet they did not understand. It consumed them, but they did not take it to heart." They did not ask, "What does this mean? What is there out there? Who can help me?" The godless have lost all sensitivity to God. And the fact is, the fact that it's been lost and described as lost suggests that there was once something there, or they were initially made to be sensitive to God, but now they have lost their spiritual sense. The word is hardened. Paul has already described them as dead in their sins in chapter 2. They are cold and so frozen, they have no desire to get warm, to get any sense or sensitivity to God. They have become callous, as the ESV translates it. Paul refers to the prophet Isaiah in the final chapter of Acts as he describes this hardness of heart. He says, "This people's heart has become callous. They hardly hear with their ears, and they have closed their eyes. Otherwise, they might see with their eyes, hear with their ears, understand with their hearts, and turn, and I would heal them." Those of us who know the love of God, those of us who know the transforming power of his Spirit, can't believe that people wouldn't even consider it, look into it. And yet this is what's described here. Of course, it's easy to look at them, but what about us? Are we protecting and promoting and growing in our spiritual sensitivity? I'm not thinking of anyone in particular, but you sometimes meet older Christians who have glaring personality flaws. I'm sure you can see them, but not yourself, of course, other people. They can be really rude. They can be aggressive or just really selfish. And I wonder, I'm talking about Christians here, I'm wondering if we're supposed to be getting progressively better, how is it possible to have such enormous blind spots in people who are supposed to be mature Christians? And I think what happens is that if we have an area that needs work, if we have an area that needs sanctification, if we have an area that the Holy Spirit is pressing on us and we neglect it, it gets worse. And initially we hide it from most people, but eventually you get so used to it that you just let it all hang out in front of everyone and anyone. God calls us away from that to be constantly being sanctified, to be constantly being renewed and growing in holiness. He calls us to listen to the Holy Spirit, to be sensitive to sin and all sin in our lives. And so God's people seek to grow in their sensitivity to God. They exercise it, they cultivate it by spending time with God in his word, by listening to the Spirit's prompting as he reveals and applies and presses on us God's word on our lives and as we live in the world. And it's not that Christians don't have times of dryness, coldness even, but God's Spirit is alive in them, and so they're not content to stay like that. I love the description of Heath Green. Not that it's a nice description, but it's a description I've often shared, but it's not a description I want to hold on to. And the description is this. He says, "My eyes are dry. My faith is old. My heart is hard. My prayers are cold. And I know how I ought to be alive to you and dead to me." It starts there, acknowledging and then seeking for God to soften again our hearts. So they've lost all sensitivity. They've also, in the second part of this verse, they've given themselves over to sensuality. When you read the Bible, you see that while people are on earth, God punishes the godless who rebel against him to varying degrees. There's little punishments and there's bigger punishments. But the final punishment, the end punishment, the last punishment of God's judgment on us, on people, while we were on earth, is when God gives them exactly what they want. It is really as if God is protecting humanity from the worst they can be, and his final judgment is to let them go. We see this throughout the scriptures. Psalm 81:12, "I gave them over to their stubborn hearts, to follow their own desires. I gave them exactly what they wanted." Acts 7:42, "But God turned away from them and gave them over to the worship of sun, moon, and stars." Romans 1:24, "Therefore God gave them over to, in their sinful desires of their heart, to sexual impurity for the degrading of their bodies with one another." Romans 1:26, "Because of this God gave them over to shameful lust. Even their woman exchanged natural sexual relations for unnatural ones." Romans 1:28, "Furthermore, just as they did not think it worthwhile to retain the knowledge of God, so God gave them over to a depraved mind, so that they do what ought not to be done." And so in this verse, we see the flip side of that, where people, as far as they're able, hand themselves over to their own destruction. And it's the flip side, because God lets them go. God gives them over to what they gladly choose. We see it with Pharaoh, don't we? God hardens Pharaoh's heart, we're told. But we also see that Pharaoh hardens Pharaoh's heart. Effectively, God hands Pharaoh over to what Pharaoh wants to hand himself over to. God gives people over to what they give themselves to. And when you're messed up in stuff that you shouldn't be messed up in, and you feel guilty and you feel you need to get out of it and you need to get back to who you're meant to be, praise God, because it means you haven't totally been given over. It means that the Holy Spirit is at work. It means the Holy Spirit is restraining and restoring and drawing you back to him. But when you can just do that stuff with abandon, when you can do that stuff and you don't care about it and you can live however you want and nothing touches you, you should be fearful, because it could mean that God has handed you over. God in his mercy can step in and awaken and bring conviction, and praise God for that. And I've seen him do that. But don't miss those times when God is speaking to you and calling you out and calling you to look to him and calling you away from those things that are so destructive. We read that they have given themselves over, it says, to sensuality. Sensuality is unrestrained living. The acts of the flesh, Galatians 5:19 says, are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity, and debauchery. They've abandoned God, abandoned themselves even, and voluntarily sacrificed to their own sexual desires. And when people's minds and lives are not open to God and his truth, they get caught up in their own ways, becoming increasingly hardened and unresponsive to God. The time can come when they lose all sensitivity to God and become lost in their ways of defiance against him. It's paradoxical that while they're dead in their sins, they're dead to God, they are yet alive or captured or eventually enslaved to their sensual desires. It's a voluntary slavery. They've given themselves over to it. In the Western world, this has reached its zenith. People take pride in what they should be ashamed of. They elevate their sexual desires, their sensual desires, their sexual preferences to the place of supreme identity. The more variance from God's revealed intention, the more pride they claim. And not only is it prevalent everywhere, we've moved in this nation beyond tolerance. Every sexuality, every deviancy must not just be approved, but it must be celebrated by all. And if you don't celebrate it, then you're a hater. And increasingly, the young are targeted. And it's not too strong to say groomed, as I talked about last week. Once it was barely 1 in 50 that identified as one of their letters, LGBT, ABCD. It used to be 1 in 50. It's now approaching 1 in 3. The grooming has been so effective. And any who don't go along with a charade, any who don't comply, are increasingly persecuted and prosecuted, and lives are being destroyed. Both those who are being caught up in it and those who are standing against it and wanting to protect children. All other freedoms are sacrificed to the protection and promotion of sexual identity. We are made by God for living lives that are real and free and godly and that are flourishing. And many want to take a shortcut to feeling alive by transitory things, by feeding the flesh. They want to feel something, even if it means mutilating themselves. I remember the Johnny Cash song, which is actually a Nine Inch Nails song, and it has these lines in it. It says, "I hurt myself today to see if I still feel. I focus on the pain, the only thing that's real." So desperate are they to feel something, they hurt themselves. And we were once no different, according to Paul. So many in the church were no different and are no different. Ephesians 2:3, all of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh, feeding the pride, whether it was the pride in doing the right thing or the pride in doing the wrong thing, following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving of wrath. And it's truly tragic when God's own people, and they do, remember this exhortation, you must no longer live as the Gentiles do. It's tragic when God's people voluntarily cut themselves off from the life of God to engage in sensuality, as if their little minds can make God disappear, as if they will be immune from the accompanying darkness and hardening of heart and culminating greed. John writes to us as he wrote to the church then in the first century, 1 John 2:15, "Do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love for the Father is not in them. For everything in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life comes not from the Father, but from the world." So in the third part of this verse, we see that they're alive, but alive to evil. People hand themselves over to indulge in every kind of impurity. Now, the Bible is not anti-sex. There's a whole book of the Bible devoted to the physical love between a husband and a wife, the Song of Songs. I've been told by non-Christian friends that the biblical view of marriage, which is do not deprive one another, is unrealistic, i.e. it has too much sex in it. And yet the Bible encourages husband and wife to enjoy each other. Proverbs 5:15, drink water from your own cistern, running water from your own well. Proverbs 5:18, may your fountain be blessed and may you rejoice in the wife of your youth. May her breast satisfy you always. May you ever be intoxicated with her love. The Bible is not anti-sex, but it's between husband and wife. And impurity is any sexual behavior outside of this exclusive marriage relationship. And the key word here is indulge. They don't just wander off, but they actively practice and give way to whatever corrupt desires fill their heads and their hearts. I love what C.S. Lewis said. He said he once described the culture's obsession with sex, and this is 60 years ago, as one that both idolizes it, puts it up as if it's God, and cheapens it, makes it nothing, destroys it, idolizes it and cheapens it. God's ways are exactly the reverse. It's meant to be a normal part of a marriage relationship, and it's a precious thing. It's evident that this was going on not only in Ephesus, but Rome, and also in Corinth. 2 Corinthians 12:21. This might describe our culture today and even our church, our churches. "I'm afraid that when I come again, my God will humble me before you, and I will be grieved over many who have sinned earlier and have not repented of the impurity, sexual sin, and debauchery in which they have indulged." Our culture is sex obsessed. Immorality is everywhere. It is normalized and celebrated and easily accessible. And with something so prevalent as this, it's inevitable that Christians get caught up in it. And how do we stand apart from all this? I should ask first, are we standing apart from all this? Not just in boldly speaking the truth and teaching God's true view of humanity, but how are we keeping ourselves from being enslaved? And we need to ask that question. This indulging in every kind of impurity has gone to a new level with graphic novels and internet pornography, and Jesus reminds us that what goes on in the heart is not in a separate, innocent category. He said, I tell you, whoever looks at a woman lustfully has already committed adultery with her in his heart. Parents today naively give unrestricted phones to their children, and then they're surprised when all the doors are unlocked and they find their children in rooms they couldn't have imagined. It's evident with the ease and encouragement and prevalence and promotion of the things in our society that Christians also are being enmeshed in it. Not so much publicly, although there's often public confessions that come out that are so damaging to the church. I could name denominations that have given themselves over to this kind of immorality and deviancy. But not so much publicly, but privately. Publicly holding the line, but privately in their hearts and behind closed doors, pursuing impurity with bold, I was going to say gay abandon, but with bold abandon. Passively welcoming whatever our streaming services provide, with no discernment, with no stops at the door, even hunting it out so that some of us are indistinguishable from our neighbours. And it works both ways. People lose sensitivity to God and become slaves to sin. And people give themselves over to sensuality, and let's call it what it is, sexual sin, and they lose their sensitivity. If we have only a cerebral relationship with God, if we don't value sensitivity to God as precious, if we're not cultivating our relationship with God, then we put ourselves in real spiritual danger. Eugene Peterson translates the verse like this: they can't think straight anymore. Feeling no pain, they let themselves go in sexual obsession, addicted to every sort of perversion. And it's a vicious cycle. As someone gives themselves over to sensuality, they lose their sensitivity. They indulge the senses, and they don't just become senseless. They can't feel anymore. They become numb to those who they should be closest to. They become expressionless. The only emotion, if they show it, is anger. And Peter gives a scathing account of all those who give themselves over to immorality in 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 14. He says, with eyes full of adultery, they never stop sinning. They seduce the unstable. They are experts in greed and a cursed brood. They promise freedom while they themselves are slaves of depravity, for people are slaves to whatever has mastered them. The psalmist, I was just reading this the other day. He said these words. I will conduct the affairs of my house with a blameless heart. This is Psalm 101. I will not look with approval on anything that is vile. Think of what we watch. Think of what we allow. It's time to move on from what we were and to be what you are as new creations in Christ. You've spent enough time, Peter says to his congregation, in the past, doing what pagans choose to do, living in debauchery, lust, drunkenness, orgies, carousing, and detestable idolatry. Christians, we need to be brutal in walking away from impurity. Colossians 3:5 says, put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature, sexual impurity, immorality, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. If we create an appetite and we feed it, it'll only grow, but it's time to starve and to kill it. I once went on a sugar fast. I was someone, I'm sure none of you like this, when you go shopping, every time you have to buy a little chocolate bar, every time, without exception, and they're there right at the counter so that we can have that ritual. And I went on a sugar fast. I avoided all added sugar. And after about a couple of weeks, I looked at those bars and I thought, what rubbish. How do people eat that stuff? I lost all desire for it. I thought, boy, people have been fooled and sucked into taking that rubbish that just is totally destructive. It didn't take me long to develop the taste again, but you've got to starve it and you've got to kill. It's always there, and you've got to treat it seriously. Put to death are the words. And finally, this verse says they are full of greed. Greed means taking more than you need, more than you should, stealing what doesn't belong to you and consuming what is far and beyond what is good for you. Stronger than that, it means an insatiable craving greed, a consuming ambition, giving rein to appetites and desires which are against the laws of God and man and which never satisfy. And notice one word here in this list of definitions, insatiable. Despite giving themselves to indulge in every type of evil, they are not satisfied at all. Now think of the rock group, the Rolling Stones. Like a whole band of King Solomon's, they had everything they could ever want, as often as they wanted it. And what was their anthem? I can't get no satisfaction. Isaiah describes this type of insatiable obsession with impurity. They are dogs with mighty appetites. They never have enough. And once they give way to one desire, there are many more, even more corrupt desires in their train waiting to be satisfied. They stuff themselves full of all types of impurity. And the sad paradox being that in spite of what they tell themselves, the more they fulfill their desires, the greater and more perverse they become and the less satisfied they feel, which is why it inevitably turns to greed. It's like trying to extinguish the fire by throwing petrol on it. Those things are prevalent in the world, and Christians are to be marked by standing apart from it. 5:3, but among you there must not be even a hint of sexual immorality or any other kind of impurity or of greed, because these are improper for God's holy people. And so it's no wonder in Romans 12:2 that Paul urges God's people to not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And it means we need to reject the values of this world. We need to establish a different way of life. But we're also not to stand totally apart. We need to pray for this world too, and pray for the people in this world. Historically, where revival happens, it comes after a long period of fervent and burdened prayer for it. James Montgomery Boyce said, "We need such a movement of God's Spirit today." Do you believe that? Do you believe it enough to pray for it? It's not enough to denounce the world's sins. It's not even enough to come out from the world and be separate. We must also pray for those we know, and we must make the Word of God known to them, seeing that it is the vehicle by which God habitually turns sinners from darkness to his marvelous light. And if you're a non-Christian here, if you're not a follower of God and you're caught up in these things and you want to come out, then look to Jesus and embrace him and say, I want you to lead my life. I want you to be in control. And so in short, how do we not do this? We do exactly the opposite. Think of those four things. Instead of being spiritually insensitive, we're to be sensitive to God. Instead of giving ourselves to evil, we're to give ourselves to God. And instead of being alive to evil, we're to starve evil and put it to death. And instead of being unsatisfied, we're to find life in all its fullness and satisfaction in him. Let us pray. Just going to play a song that I mentioned, and I just invite you just to recite these words in your prayer, and then I'll close in prayer. Thank you.
fever is over, my heart is hard, my prayers are cold, and I know how I ought to be alive to you, dead to me. Like mine, soften it up with oil and wine. The oil is you, your spirit of love. Please wash me anew in the wine of your love. Sing it together to the Lord. Close your eyes. Sing it to Jesus. Unless your heart is not hard, your eyes are not dry, your prayers are not cold, your faith is not over. Otherwise, that just about means all of us, then. My eyes are dry, faith is open. My faith is open. My heart is open, and I know how to be alive to you, dead to me. What can be done?
Yes, Father, help us to be people who are sensitive to you. We thank you that your spirit and mercy continues to call us and speak to us. And Lord, help us to be people who hear your voice and respond to your voice. Help us to be people who live as living sacrifices, giving to you. Help us to put to death the things of the flesh. And Lord, we thank you that our hearts are restless until they find their rest in you. We thank you that in you there is deep and great and unsurpassed satisfaction, a satisfaction that begins and increases into eternity. Father, we thank you for your great love for us that has made it possible that we can come before your throne room. And Lord, that we can be dead to sin, but alive to you. Because in you there is true and real life. In Jesus' name. Amen.